So this is a session that I've been looking forward to actually for a few years.
I'm so glad I came.
Because, turn off the right mic. That's because, as was said in the introduction, then there's a handful of Danish unicorns over the last 10 years. Three of them moved to San Francisco, one of them moved to London, all for probably good reasons, but one of them stayed here in the Danish Anadam. And that's Sitecore. And at the same time, Sitecore is not a very well-described story. Probably also partly because it's not a consumer tech company, but also partly because the co-founder and CEO, Michael Seifert, sitting here, he's really not too fond of the whole thing about presenting a story and talking to everybody about that. So it took me 2 years to convince Michael that he should come here and talk about Sitecore. Of course, it's not the full story. We can't do that in 25 minutes. But at least we'll get a bit of an insight into the story, and you will have an opportunity to ask questions via Slido. So, again, Michael, thank you for coming.
Thank you, Klaus, for convincing me.
Maybe first, since no one knows you, yeah. Because you are not in any TV programs or anything. Who are you? What's your background?
Yes, yeah, so. I guess I'll start by saying I grew up a large part of my childhood on the island of Bornholm. It's a nice but very quiet island. And my mother lived there, my father lived in America, so I went to America in my summers. And I think when I was about 11, I fell in love for the first time. I was over having a summer holiday with my dad. I went with him to his company, and then I saw it, an Apple II Plus computer. And it was amazing. And I got it for Christmas present after, and then I just started coding. And I coded and coded. I got terrible grades in elementary school because I was coding too much. Got even worse grades in high school because I coded so much, and just barely made it into computer science at Copenhagen University after trying twice. But in computer science, it went really well because I had coded most of my life. Then you should think I would have had enough coding by then, but no. So when I was done with my computer science studies in the afternoon, then I'd code something called DQMod in the evening together with some other enthusiasts from up there. It became a really big and interesting game. We had more than 1 million people play it worldwide.
This was so about what time is this?
This is 1992. So the World Wide Web wasn't even invented back then, but we're using Telnet, which was available to the universities. I finished computer science and moved to the US and got the great idea that I wanted to start an internet casino. And there were none at the time, and it was a great idea. But then legislation turned really sour, and if you ran an internet casino, you'd go 8 years to jail. And if you were an American citizen playing an internet casino, you'd go 1.5 years to jail. So I decided to change my line of business. And it's about then, I think I moved back to Denmark and started an IT consulting company called Pentia together with four colleagues from university.
Which actually still exists to this day?
Still exists today. I think there are about 75 people. Same kind of awesome company culture and does mostly consulting, mostly web. Back then, when we founded the company, we decided at the very end, we had a board of directors meeting, if you can even call it that, and at the very last point, it said miscellaneous. Michael says that we should invent a software product that we can sell globally because it scales more easily than building a consulting company.
Very wise words.
Yeah, thank
and
you.
And this is 1998.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, and then I know that in you started working on various websites for companies, and then one of your co-founders, he did something technology-wise,
yeah,
and you were
right.
A bit critical, and then that actually was the Sitecore product.
Yeah.
I think that's a very educational story.
No, that's right. We actually invented, I think, two or three different products before we ran into Sitecore. I was managing director for Pentia, and we discarded the other ideas. They didn't quite work as well as we had thought. But then one day, we had a big web project for a large international Danish company. And my co-founder Ole, he had gone 200 hours over budget on this particular assignment. And I was counting the cash, and we didn't make a profit on that assignment. So I had Ole down to my desk, say, "Hey Ole, how the heck can you use 200 hours too much?" And said, "Well, I invented this thing. It's really cool. It's an API. So the next time I'll build a website, it'll be much faster." And I scolded Ole and told him never to do that again. Then we actually tried to get money for what Ole had built by selling it to one of our subcontractors. And they refused. They wouldn't pay 50,000 for it. So I was kind of stuck with it. And
what if they paid you? Then they would own a big chunk of Sitecore.
Yeah, they would have owned half. Yeah.
Okay.
So we were stuck with it. But then the next time Ole actually made a web project, it was a lot faster than the previous time. And we could see we made more and more profits on our web projects. And then we just kept working with it for about, I think, half a year to a year. Until we decided, hey, we're really on to something.
What gave you the insight to say, okay, we need to have a fundamental discussion about this?
We reached at a scale, I think we'd built about 13, 14 sites with it, and we just had to make a decision, are we going to continue to invest in this API framework? Are we going out to pick something standard from the market? And so what we did was we had a board of directors meeting and talked about what's really special about what we built, what's in the market, and we actually ended up identifying exactly what we did differently.
And what was that?
Well, that was we had the ability to build only dynamic websites. And everybody else, they publish static sites. And dynamic websites just gave you, we thought, a lot of advantage in e-commerce and integrations. And of course, as I'll talk about later, it'll give a huge advantage in personalizing website experiences.
Mm. And then you basically said, okay, let's double down on this. Let's make a separate company.
Yeah.
And a few of you guys decided to break out.
Yeah, four of us went into Sitecore. The remaining 20 employees stayed in Pentia and three of the co-founders there. And then we started Sitecore.
And you went with Sitecore because that was the global scalable software product that you wanted to build.
Yeah.
And how did you, I guess, from a founder perspective, it's a bit difficult to make that split and who should own how much and who should take how much risk in the new company? How did that whole conversation go?
We didn't even have that conversation because knowing that we wanted to build a global software company, from the beginning we had set up a company structure to deal with it. So we all just shared equally in the setup.
So you actually knew from the beginning that the consultancy business anyway had to be the breeding ground for the one big idea.
Yeah. And so we had a company structure back then, very complicated, but what's called an inverted Christmas tree, and the consulting company was here and Sitecore was here.
Okay.
It was quite straightforward. We didn't even talk about it. We didn't have to.
Okay. And then what happened? How did you get traction on this? Did it take a while or was it quickly or?
Yeah, you know, it took, 15 years?
No, 15 years you became a unicorn, what happened the first couple of years? Was it more difficult than you expected or was it just around the highway?
It was tough and a lot of fun. And I mean, the first thing we did that anybody being a super nerd like I am had to hire a head of sales. And so we got hold of a great sales guy and he helped us. We had a strategy to build a partner network. He helped us build the partner network, close a lot of deals. And that was
This is a classic challenge for someone from a technical background that is the CEO to find this mythical creature called a sales guy with a brain that works very differently. What is your advice to CEOs today that have a tech background that need to find that CSO or head of sales or whatever?
I don't think I have any. I have to say, for all 15 years, it just remains super elusive exactly how to identify a great salesperson from a mediocre sales.
But somewhere or another, you managed to do it, right? Or maybe the product was so good, it just sold itself.
No, it absolutely wasn't. It is a lot of hard work to sell it. So.
Okay.
Yeah.
I can see there's not yet any questions, so we'll just keep talking here.
Maybe I should just explain just briefly what Sitecore does.
Yes.
Because Sitecore is a software company. I stopped in Sitecore in 2017. We started out building what's called web content management, which really means you're editing your website. Like, imagine you're using Word just on your website. You delete pages, you add pages, you update pages. But we had a change of strategy around 2007 where we changed from just building websites to building what's called web experience management. And that really means we try to serve up a personalized experience to every visitor on the website based on what they're clicking on and based on what they did the last time they were there.
So becoming an e-commerce platform almost.
But not even information sites can be personalized, right? And we ended up with offices in about 16 countries, a revenue of 250 million US, 1,000 employees globally. Today, the company has about 1,400 employees globally. So yeah, it was quite a journey.
So I remember back in the days when you started with this, I was also involved in the whole online thing, and there was quite a lot of content management systems. As you say, a lot of them were static and so on, but you also had the big guys coming out there. You had IBM with WebSphere being pushed by globally by thousands and thousands of consultants and all the credibility of the Big Blue. And you also had some other competitors out there. And basically today, you more or less have been beating all of them.
Yeah. No, that's right.
Yeah, you have to explain the audience, but I mean, is it down to your brilliance or, you know, what, why, how?
So first of all, we super diverse competitive environment. When we began, I think we had about 2,500 competitors globally. That's a crazy number, right? No sane person would start a business in that area if there were so many systems out there. But apparently we did anyway. And what was also interesting is that for the first many, many years, until about 2014 or 15, we would see different competitors in every country. So every country, go to Denmark, Sweden, Norway, Germany, America, England, Australia, all different competitors. There wasn't one single competitor we'd meet everywhere, not until Adobe came in 2000.
What about IBM WebSphere?
No. Saw it on dispersed deals. We didn't see them that much. I think they were mostly in for their established customer base. And so what we do? I think a few things. We started out with a really strong product. As I said, we could build these dynamic web pages. But I think the real change came in 2007 when I had a slightly provocative board of directors meeting where I had a few slides. And the last slide said, web content management is dead, rest in peace. That kind of got everybody out of the seats. And I said, we have to find more business value than just editing content, right? We have people looking at it, getting these experiences. We have to be able to adapt the experience and serve up personalized.
Is that because you realized it became a commodity?
Yeah.
You need to have a differentiator.
Yeah. So everybody was building a more and more advanced editor with more and more buttons and more features. And I just thought we couldn't keep up in the long run. We had to reinvent it somehow.
But there's one thing is to take that decision. The other one is to execute on it.
Yeah.
You must have been pretty good at attracting very smart technical minds and making them work together in a good, creative, collaborative way.
Yes, I think probably, and maybe even more so. We hired some really good product marketing people, and we spent a lot of energy working with influencers, especially with Gartner and Forrester. And
that's quite interesting. Can you maybe expand a little bit more on that from
sure.
a B2B perspective? That's quite an interesting way of building your credibility in a sector.
So as soon as you're in the, not in the SMB market, but in the enterprise market or low enterprise market, upper mid market, Gartner is kind of, and Forrester, they're the go-to reports and resources for these companies to make purchasing decisions. So it was really key for us to be in the report in the first place. And if you have a really well-working product marketing department, you'll be working consistently with the same analysts, preferably year over year. And every year you're in the report. If you do your job well, you'll move a little better up in the report, and hopefully you end up in the upper right-hand corner. Right?
The magic quadrant.
Yeah, exactly. And we were in the upper right-hand corner, I think, after working with them for 7 or 8 years. And they give you feedback, you give them feedback, and I think we also influenced them to move in the web experience management direction, and they influenced us to also work on our product. So it was a good relationship, and it was the number one lead source for our company. And it's bloody expensive.
Impressive.
Yeah.
I can see there's a question coming up here, which is also on my list, which is back to my introduction. So why is Sitecore still headquartered in Copenhagen?
Yeah, great question. I'm not sure why the other guys moved. I have an idea. So we didn't really have any compelling reason to move. Denmark's a great place to have a company. I think the tax rate is extremely reasonable. If you move, I can only imagine it's probably because you end up with maybe an American venture capitalist company, and they tend to think, or at least tended to think, that anything outside of America, that's kind of fouled into the boonies, right? So we better take this weird Danish construct we know nothing about and move it to America. We didn't have any venture capitalist in the company until 2011, right? So we were quite sizable by then. And sure, they tried.
Oh, they did?
Oh, yeah, they wanted us to move, but they didn't really come up with any compelling reason to why we should spend all that energy moving. It can be, if you have IPO plans, it might make sense, but it's absolutely possible to do IPO.
I guess also, if you look at your where your market is, where your customers they are, mm-hmm. of course, a lot of them are in the US, but it's not like US is half your addressable market. Because in that way, it could be.
Yeah, it's kind of, I think it's about half addressable market.
Okay,
yeah.
so you could have had, by being in the US, you could have, but you managed to build a structure. I know you lived in the US as well for a while.
Yeah, I did, and because the venture capitalists wanted me in the US, right? They wanted a stronger US presence. And so we ended up having some of our executive team in the US, some in Denmark, headquarters still in Denmark legally, though, even though I was in the US.
When did you take on investments, and from who? How did that change the company? And may I add, why did you take in money in 2011?
Yeah. So I would say the first few years of Sitecore's life, we were very dependent on Pensure, as you alluded to before, right? They were kind of our financial aid when we had end of year fiscal trouble. But then, I think already from 2005, we were profitable, and we could grow pretty much almost as much as we wanted based on the profits we made. And so the first investment we took in was in 2011 from a company called Technology Crossover Ventures. Yes. They bought a minority share in Sitecore, so they didn't have control. We remained in control as founders. And it was for risk diversification purposes. There was no money that was put into the company. And especially my co-founders, I was kind of at the helm, right? So I wasn't worried, but my co-founders.
They were worried about you.
Yeah, they were worried about me.
And you knew yourself, so you were not worried. Okay, I like that's a good argument.
Yeah, so it's fair enough, right? So
Actually, talking about you as being CEO, again, you were there from when a few guys broke out and said, we want to do this, we have a few customers, and a basic product, and then all the way up to 1,000 people globally, winner in the Magic Quadrant and all that. How, at a personal level, was that experience for you? Because it's a lot of years, right?
That's crazy.
Few people are CEO throughout that entire journey over so many years.
Yeah, no, it's super challenging, right? You've got to have some passion for what you're doing, otherwise you're not going to get through it. And every 18 months, I would find myself in an entirely new situation that I had never tried before, with a new set of challenges. It could be marketing, could be sales, could be product organization. Just some new challenge that you had never faced before that you needed to work your way through. It's kind of like going into the jungle and just trying to find a path through it.
And what is your advice then to people who haven't tried it before, like you, and going through this? What kind of tools did you use? Mm. Do you think you're just a natural talent, or are you lucky, or what do you think? Yeah.
So I think probably my two most important pieces of advice is, number one, you have to have an incredible amount of passion about what you're going to do. If you don't have that, you're just plain and simply going to run out of energy, because it's a tough job. And then you have to build a company culture, right? Company culture is incredibly important. Think about a house, right? If a big hurricane comes in, the house gets smashed. The culture of your company is the foundation of the house. If you don't have a strong foundation, everything will be gone. But if you have a strong foundation, you can weather even a really tough storm, because you have something to rebuild on. And all companies, including Sitecore, have had ups and downs.
It's so funny, because I think when you talk about, like, I know you mean it, and I think it's only people who've really been through a journey like that understand that the soft parts are really the most valuable thing. It is the hardest part. And so back to the ups and downs, there's a question here. Biggest crisis, what was it? How did you cope with it? Did you solve it?
Yeah, I probably think.
I know the financial crisis gave you a bit of a in 2008.
Yeah, but that didn't really turn out a crisis for us. I'll say it anyway, even though my accountant told me never to tell this story. So we were growing at 100% year over year. The financial crisis hit, and oh my God, we grew only 50% the year after. And I called my accountant and said, I can't believe it, we're down to 50% growth. And he was silent for a very long time. He said, Michael, don't say that to anyone. They think you need to get admitted.
So that was not really a crisis. What was the crisis?
It was kind of tough.
Maybe building a new executive team, I could imagine, culturally is very difficult.
Exactly. And it was the intersection exactly of that, right? Getting a new venture capitalist on board, having on our behalf really high ambitions. We were growing 30, 40% at that place and time. And they wanted us to grow 60% or more, right? So we tried to put in an exec team. We tried to build out.
How many of those execs you hired were there 2 years later?
None.
Yeah. Why?
Because, of course, you can't just go from 40 to 60% growth in a relatively short period of time, right? It's going to take a longer period of time, especially for companies.
I guess also culturally, maybe it was a bit of a problem to have so many new guys coming in one go.
Yeah, the problem was, you can say, I think both the plan and the culture. And it was the mix of the two that made it really difficult to come through it. And so we had a rather big restructuring, the first ever in the company's history, back in 2015, I think.
And you didn't hire new people, new executives?
Yeah.
Problem solved. let's see, what else? There's one here. What are your future plans?
As in my?
I think it's your. I can see we're running out of time.
Okay.
So I think that's going to be the last question. You personally, what are your future plans? I know you're playing guitar on Tuesdays.
Yeah. Not just on Tuesdays. I play guitar 1 hour every day. I decided I wanted to be good at playing electric guitars, and it's incredible tough work. And then I spend time in Nordic Makers, investing a little bit in Danish tech startups.
What kind of tech startups do you enjoy the most?
Doesn't matter, as long as it's exciting and makes me happy. I'll look at it.
That's cool.
And then time with my family.
Okay, good. I think we should give Michael an extra big applause, because that would make him really uncomfortable. Yay! Woo!
Thank you.
Thank you.